Amazon will soon be sending out a robot to your home to deliver packages. Google Assistant hits 1 billion devices, and you can now purchase a smartphone that folds in three. Stewart and Travis caught up with Mike McAvoy, CEO of top news parody site The Onion, and I caught up with some sleep after Consumer Electronics Show. You may soon be ditching your iPhone or Note for a new flip phone if Motorola has their way, but since the Doomsday clock is just 2 minutes from midnight, does it matter anyway? Huh, let's do this.
Ready for your hot fix of tech news with the latest apps, sexy software, and groovy gadgets. You've got it with the bad boys of tech. Take it away, gentlemen.
And thank you, lovely Anastasia. It is the Bad Boys of Tech. I'm Joel Com, and that guy over there, that nerd, that geek, that dweeb, that dork, that's Mr. Travis Wright.
You are so nice. You say the kindest things to me.
Well, I say
it all.
Still
my heart.
Lovingly.
Yeah, that's good. If you do that to a dog, you little dirty little piece of shit.
Yeah.
Like, you just, I can't believe the dumb shit you do. Like,
yeah.
Mr. Stuart Rogers, the digital nomad, is not available to join us today, but we do have a great interview that both Travis and Stuart conducted with the CEO of The Onion, and it's a really good interview. You guys are going to want to stick around for it, and I wasn't there, but I have heard it.
Yeah, we did that interview a while back, and great dude. He said, hey, you know what? If you're ever in the area, drop by the Onion's office. I would love to watch their headline creation process because he says it's like a work of art.
Oh my gosh. It must be hysterical. They probably have the best time.
Yes. Well, maybe we can work out. We can go there and do a meeting there sometime. I want to sit through that. It would be so hilarious to see. Yeah. I bet it would be inspiring. And our headlines would magically become better.
I'd be okay with
your
that.
Your teasers would become magically better. It's so good.
But would our
my
rock
jokes
and roll
would hit better?
Would our rock and roll stingers become better? I don't think so. It's time for the news. Let's jump right in here. Amazon, of course, Jeff Bezos and Amazon taking over the world. And there's something coming to Washington, Snohomish County in particular, which is near Amazon's Seattle home base. They are working on delivery robots. These are self-driving machines. There's six of them that are already on the streets delivering packages in this one neighborhood. They navigate themselves, but they've got like a walker with them for now just to make sure, you know, they don't get hung up anywhere.
Now, what's interesting about this is like these are going to start clogging the sidewalks and like, excuse me, could you imagine those in New York City, like all over the place? Like, excuse me, like it's, I think it would be impossible to do that in New York City with, because most people live in these really tall buildings and there's probably at that place has so many packages being delivered at once, right? If they're doing that effectively, that's got to be a logistical nightmare, Mr. Joelcom.
I imagine it is, but you know what? These things are about the size of a small cooler, and it moves along at walking pace. Basically, it says Prime on the side. It's blue. It's got six wheels on it. It's called the Amazon Scout, and it's powered by battery. So I don't know how long the charge on it lasts, but I guess it somehow.
Dude, it's like it's freaking Wally, dude. They invented Wally. That's exactly what it is. It's coming to bring in your package, and then it gets sad, and then everybody goes off on the spaceship and gets fat over the next couple hundred years.
I'm fat now. So
you don't have to do anything anymore. Everything gets delivered to you. It's almost like Wally, where we don't have to move.
I'm already
we can just
fat.
Sit at our computer.
What do you think I do now? I sit in front of my computer all the time talking about technology, getting fat.
Yeah, we got to get you out of the house more, brother.
I do actually. I walk an hour a day. If it's sunny outside, warm, I'll go walk around here in Denver or wherever I'm traveling. If not, there's a treadmill here in my building, and I go do that as I did today.
Very nice. Yeah. Very nice. But soon you won't have to, because Scout will just do all that stuff for you. Amazon is going to have everything. Amazon eventually will be feeding us. Mm-hmm. Well, here's the Amazon robot food eater. It will put the fork right in here for you. It will cut your food for you. Nom, 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 nom. Thank you, Amazon, Jeff Bezos.
Which, you know, if Amazon is making it so that we are not getting the fitness that we need, that's an ethical issue. But here's one, an ethical issue that is even worse. Apparently, in China, these researchers have cloned five monkeys that their genes have been edited, and they've got all kinds of genetic disease symptoms. You know, of course, they're doing research on these monkeys, but they're harming them in doing it. Mm-hmm. These poor little monkeys.
Yeah, so this is pretty interesting. They don't have the problem like they'll say, hey, we will clone. We will do anything we can if they want. Medically, in America, you can't actually do clonings. That's illegal. And it is a crazy ethical thing to think if they could take your exact DNA and then make a brand new exact one of you. That's just wild to think about. And so that's what they did with these monkeys. But then they went in and edited their genes.
Yeah.
So now they have new. What were they trying to change?
They wanted to change their Levi's to a more, you know, designer brand. Oh, not those kind of jeans? Different jeans.
Different jeans. Okay. Different jeans.
Different jeans. Yeah. I mean, obviously they're doing research on them, but, you know, I'm sure animal rights activists are not happy about this at all. And I'm not an activist, and I'm kind of like, you know, you're making these monkeys crazy. I don't like the whole cloning thing at all. I think that, you know, we have ventured into an area where we are literally playing God with, you know, life. And I'm not down with that. You know, call me old fashioned if you have to, but I don't think it's cool.
Yeah, there's junkies with monkey disease. Who's touching these monkeys? Please leave these poor sick monkeys alone. They got problems enough as it is.
I think you just violated copyright by quoting Flight of the Conchords.
Oh, man. I don't know.
Now we're going to get sued.
It's technology. Now we're going to get sued. It didn't sound anything like them singing it, though.
So it did. It wasn't good. It was bad.
It was very bad. Good stuff.
So
China.
Yeah.
Next.
Next story. This one from Engadget. By the way, the stories that we picked, these are stories that are interesting to us. There's always, you know, there's plenty of tech stories every day, whether they're software, apps, gadgets, or, you know, news, science. And these are ones that catch our eye. And this one caught my eye because, you know, MoviePass has been a membership site for quite some time, and they are changing their pricing scheme so that you can have an unlimited movie plan, all the movies you want for a certain fee. And this is going to be interesting to see how this turns out because, you know, the whole model for watching movies is been turned on its head by Netflix and Amazon Prime and such.
That's true.
But this is for movie theaters.
This is actual movie theaters. But now, conversely, the price of popcorn is now $37 for a small.
Have you been to one of those theaters yet where, you know, they can serve you a meal, you know, not just mm-hmm. snacks, but it's like these recliners and there's, you know, tables, trays that you pull in front of you. You order your meal in the lobby and then they bring it to you and they bring you drinks. I like that.
Yeah, it's pretty fancy. You know, but I think about this is that going to movies is not something that I do a whole lot of anymore.
Mm-hmm. Me either.
It's like, I don't go to movie theaters. I don't feel like if I want to see something, I can wait. I don't have an overall. I realized I went to less than five movies last year. I think it was three.
Then you went to more than I did because I probably went to one.
Nice.
Yeah. Nice. I'm, you know, it's just, there's something about the theater that for some films, it's good, but people are obnoxious. You know, they're making all this noise and they're, you know, and they're talking during the film. And I'm just like, shut up.
You have VR, don't you? You have a VR.
I do. Well, actually, I'm just getting ready to sell my Oculus Rift because Oculus is coming out with a new device this spring that's going to be wireless. But yes, I do. Oh, I do have an Oculus Rift.
Well, then you can. There's like a theater app in there where you can basically put your movie in and then watch it on VR. Yeah. that's maybe what this movie pass should do, is like, look, and we'll also sell it to you on VR so you can have a theater by yourself so you don't got to worry about all the rude people around you turning on their phones and smacking and talking their lips.
You know, right? I haven't, I never watched a movie in VR on my device because I don't want to sit with this thing on my head for 90 minutes.
It is kind of heavy.
But it's just, I don't know. I prefer the comfort of my sofa. And again, with a Rift and a Vive, you're still tethered to a computer or a device. But this new one that's coming out, and we'll be reporting on that, is supposed to be wireless and doesn't require a computer. So it's better than the Oculus Go, which is kind of like a budget VR device that I'm glad I didn't buy.
You know, VR is really cool. I mean, that's the whole thing about it. If you don't have the main one, like I can put my cell phone and little head, the VR viewer or whatever, and then you got that screen right next to your face. And I'm ready for these next generation AR glasses. I can't wait for those. I think there's going to be so many cool applications of that. Like Google Glass was kind of cheesy because it was just covered this one little spot. But if you got these like goggles that you can see and you can place different screens in different places and stuff, that's just going to be such a game changer.
We need alternate reality because we all see reality so clearly as it is.
Yeah.
Hey, Travis, yeah. What time is it?
It is 4:30.
Nope, it's not. It's 2 minutes to midnight.
Mm. Again? Yeah.
Again, it's 2 minutes to midnight. And of course, I'm referring here to the Doomsday clock that is monitored by the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists. So we're only 2 minutes to midnight. It's almost over again.
So, you know, what is midnight?
Midnight is end of the world. Midnight means the end of the world.
Yeah.
So this was something that they came up with during the Cold War. And the idea was that this would measure how close the world was to nuclear annihilation. They started it in 1947. But now
specifically that, nuclear. Or have they expanded it now?
Not nuclear. Nuclear. Say it with me. Nuclear.
Nuclear.
You are now qualified to run for president of the United States. That they're nuclear. I mean, Clinton said it. Bush said it.
That's the one hillbilly word I haven't gotten rid of in Missouri.
Nuclear. But in 2007, they expanded what they were tracking with the Doomsday Clock to also consider climate change, which, you know, according to those who think that we're all doomed for that, is what's moving us closer to midnight. So, and if you listen
and they say information warfare,
mm-hmm.
There's a war for your mind out there, people. They're turning frogs gay.
You know, wasn't it? It was when Al Gore released his film that he said by last year that the ice caps would have melted and we'd all be underwater. And that's why that Hollywood movie, you know, The Day After Tomorrow was made and there was all this hysteria. And of course, that time has passed and he was wrong. And yet he's still getting paid big bucks to speak about climate change. And it was just this very week that new congresswoman from New York, I think, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, said that we have 12 years left and then we're done because of climate change.
Al Gore, you know, he made the Inconvenient Truth, but the Inconvenient Truth is he lives in this mansion up there with these transdimensional aliens. Infowars.com. Alex Jones, I got to get on different shows like this because they don't let me on social media. Back to you, Joel.
This woman actually said that we're done in 12 years. It's over. If we don't resolve climate change right now, that's just irresponsible.
Yeah, Trump said, we really don't pay attention to what she says. So they said that, and I was like, oh my God, what? If you just look at this for what it is, it's a comedy. Like, politics is a comedy. The way that people pull everybody's strings and make them all scream and get angry at whatever on a whim, it's amazing how quickly the media can make everyone so mad. And you step away, media can't make you mad anymore because you go, mm-hmm.
By the way, the climate is changing. In fact, it was snowing in Denver this morning, and now it's cleared up and the sun is shining. So I have verifiable evidence today that climate change is real.
Mm. My kid was playing baseball, you know, last year, and it was like hot. It was like in the 90s. And then the next thing you know, it was like you literally felt it go like a wall of coldness just hit. And then we got back to the car and it was like 57 degrees. I was like, oh my God, it just dropped 30 degrees in like 2 minutes. Like that wall just came in. It was crazy.
So according to Cortez, we've got 12 years. The doomsday clock says 2 minutes. And in spite of that, technology marches on and the flying car will soon be a reality. And this story from VentureBeat.com, which is where our co-host Stuart Rogers writes for, says Boeing is in the race for their flying car, and they have a prototype that hovered briefly in the air on its inaugural test flight. It's competing with the arch rival Airbus SE and other firms that are introducing small self-flying vehicles capable of vertical takeoff and landing. Man, I can't wait to try one of these.
Well, you're not going to get to, Joel, because there's only 2 minutes left until the end of the world. And of course, they're going to make these cars now at the end of the world. So finally we get flying car. Nope, we're all dead. It's so great. So excited about that. I'm curious about this, though. Say there's like hundreds and thousands of these flying up in the air and they're all using this downward propulsion and shooting wind, however they're doing it. They're using sort of reverse thrust in some cases. Something they're trying to use magnets, and I don't know if they haven't figured it out yet. But like, what is that going to do to the environment and to weather if everybody's creating these massive winds?
I don't know. That's a good question. Boeing in this article says is also working on an Uber air service for flights that you should be able to call an Uber that you can order via your phone around 2023. That's just 4 years from now.
That stuff's going to be huge in LA and New York. Mm-hmm. That will be big because you literally like, I need to go to that building. You're like, nope, now I got to go down the elevator, get in a taxi or get in the subway, cruise up, like, or just go, vroom. You're going to be able just to hop on buildings, and there's going to be these big Uber plane hubs on top of buildings and big cities.
Of course, you could see the links to this story and all the other stories in the show notes at badboysoftech.com. Just look for episode number 2 and you will find that there. Lots of cool apps to talk about, Mr. Travis, right? Speaking of Uber, how'd you like to get rewarded for using Uber? You know, up to this point, you don't earn any points for using Uber or Lyft or any of those, but they're getting ready to roll out Uber rewards. So you'll earn points towards blue, gold, platinum, and diamond status.
Wow. I mean, I wonder how many rides that I've been on. I know I've been on a ton. We're on different cities. Everywhere I go, I try to use an Uber first because I don't like to use a taxi. Taxi drivers normally won't speak very good English. And I've noticed that they like to take the long way, so they charge more. And you never know how much that right fee is. At least on Uber, it's like, oh, that was 22 euros. Wow. If you take a taxi, you're like, oh, 50 euros. And you have no idea like what you should be paying. So I have to have this, and especially in different countries.
Now, Lyft actually announced a rider loyalty program back in December, but it has not manifested because I've used Lyft and there is nothing in the app yet about earning points and using them. So the two are in a battle. But here's some of the things that you can get if you you get gold at 500 points. So you can get $5 in Uber cash for every 500 points. So basically 100 points is equal to $1. And the way that you earn those points is you get 1 point for every dollar spent on Uber Pool and Uber Eats, 2 points for every dollar spent on Uber X, and 3 points if you use the premium services for every dollar.
That is completely fascinating. It's needed. You know, actually, they're starting to roll out the Chipotle rewards, too. I'm here in Kansas City, and this is the opening market for it. And it just makes sense to me. Like, if you on Uber a whole lot, man, get some points and get some discounts and stuff. That's huge.
What happens if you order Chipotle with Uber Eats? Do you get rewards for both of them?
I think you'd have to do Dash. But that's one thing about it. If you have a car now and you're like, man, I really need some extra money, and you live in a decent city, go to Uber and Lyft and Uber Eats and Dash, and then somebody's going to send you a message to do something. And the amount of money that people can make in this new freelancing crowd surf world is just crazy.
Well, here's
don't need where bosses anymore. You we don't need bosses, Mr. Jocom.
I haven't had a boss in so long. You can get Uber rewards now if you live in Boston, Dallas, Orange County, Houston, New Orleans, Kansas City, Indianapolis, L.A., San Francisco, Fort Collins. It says Rockies. I wonder if we have it here in Denver. Oh, here. Launch cities yeah. included Miami, Denver, Tampa, New York, D.C., Philly, Atlanta, San Diego, and anywhere in New Jersey. So I'm going to see what kind of perks I get on my Ubers.
Very nice. I'm going to check this out right now. Is it a separate app?
No, you should be earning them in Uber, but you might have to upgrade it, and you might have to go to the website to see your rewards. I don't know, because I haven't seen it yet.
What does that mean? What do you mean update? I don't understand this, Sonny. Talk English. It's my iPhone I got for Christmas.
More apps. Many people use Instagram stories. There's like over a billion Instagram users, and I don't know how many people Netflix has right now, but allegedly in this story from The Next Web, you can now share your Netflix favorites to your Instagram stories if and only if you have an iPhone. So if you're in the Netflix app on iOS and you pick a title, then you go to the share button. And now, on top of the regular things that you would share to, like Twitter and messages, Instagram Stories is in there, and it pulls up a cool show card that, you know, will be sized for your Instagram story. You could embellish it like you do on stories. You know, you can put questions on it.
It's genius. How much do you love this show? You can put the questions on. I love that idea. Really smart by Netflix. That's one thing about Netflix. They, from when they started out with those DVDs, right, and how they've moved on and evolved, not too many companies are able to evolve like that. And they made that switch to streaming, and man, they've taken it over, man. Good job on that.
They're working on the Android version, but, you know, did Netflix make a mistake is the question. You know, they raised their prices recently. They jumped up their plans for between 13% and 18%, which the company was going to use to finance more original films and pay off accrued debt. But at the same time,
they got to pay off the Obamas. They paid them like $200 million or something. Mm-hmm.
At the same time, Hulu lowered their prices by a couple dollars. So was that a misstep for Netflix to increase their prices while Hulu is lowering theirs? Because honestly, look, there's a lot of stuff on Netflix, but from my opinion perspective, a lot of it is crap. There's a lot of crap out there.
You know, it's like I realize as I don't watch as much TV as I used to watch, right? And so it's like I'm becoming a curmudgeon. It's like I like to research other stuff. I watch a lot of videos on YouTube if I'm going down and checking things out. But streaming media is such a huge part of our life now. And you can take it on one device, look at your TV, go over here, put it on your Mac. I mean, it's worth it. Like, what is the price of that? If the $10 mobile movie pass or whatever is worth $10, freaking, you know, Netflix is worth $10. Seriously, Netflix is worth like $50 a month.
Well, think of how many of us have cut the cord to all cable. Now, I'm not a sports fan, so I don't need the sports channels. And I have there's no reason to subscribe to HBO just to watch Silicon Valley. I mean, there's just not enough reason to do it. So I pay for Netflix. I pay for Hulu without commercials because I don't want to see any. And I'm an Amazon Prime member. I've got all of the programming I could possibly want and then some. Who needs cable?
And if you don't have it, well, then you can go on Apple iTunes and rent it. It has pretty much every one of them. I was flying back from Budapest and from Budapest, New York, and the plane. I guess we had a nice tailwind. We got there like an hour and 20 minutes ahead of schedule. That's how fast we got there. And so the movie that I was watching is the new King Arthur movie by Guy Ritchie, and I had like the last 25 minutes left of the movie. And I was like, what? We're not supposed to, like, we've already arrived. And I was like, no, like that was the only movie that I was watching on there. I slept before. And so actually I looked at every single option. I looked at Hulu, not there. Netflix, not there. And then I looked at Amazon Prime, not there. I had to go to, because it was on Cinemax. And so I had to go to Apple iTunes and rent it for 48 hours for like $2.99 or something. can't just not see the last 20 minutes of a movie.
There's also, you know, Google Play. You could rent movies. There's other networks that you could rent stuff. And of course, for those who don't care, there's all kinds of streaming services that are less scrupulous where you can watch first rate, you know, first run movies and shows for free. And I'm not going to tell you how to do that. Figure it out yourself. Oh, but have you seen yet, Travis, on either Netflix or Hulu, the documentaries about the failed Fire Festival?
Yeah, I watched that last night.
Which one did you watch, the Netflix or the Hulu one?
I watched the Netflix one.
Okay, so the Netflix one is Fire, the greatest party that never happened. Now, mm-hmm. do you know who funded and produced that documentary?
I don't. I've not seen it, but based on the slant of the video and the footage that they had, it looked like they were the videographers for the original Fire Festival who probably didn't get paid by that Billy McFarland dude. And so they had all this footage and decided to make it a documentary on their own.
Okay, that was my assumption. You have to go to Hulu and watch. So the Netflix one is called Fire, the greatest party that never happened. You guys got to go check it out. If you don't know what the Fire Festival was, F-Y-R-E, this was Ja Rule and this young entrepreneur, Billy McFarland. This was supposed to be the concert festival event of events on a private island in the Bahamas with surrounded by beautiful influencers. And it was a disaster. The one on Hulu is called Fire Fraud, and I did not find out until the end of Fire Fraud who produced the other documentary. You find out because and once you know, you'll be like, oh, that makes a lot more sense. So I don't want to, that's kind of a spoiler for people. I recommend you watch the Netflix one first because you won't know where the bias is, and then watch the Hulu one. And very entertaining, really sad for the people that were burned by this guy. But I kind of lump him in with Jordan Belfort in terms of, you know, scumbag level.
Yeah, you know, it was an interesting thing. So many people got hosed, and they were just throwing money everywhere. Like they paid Kylie Jenner $250,000 for like one, maybe three social media posts on her Instagram. Dude, they just literally wired her $250,000. They were throwing monies at celebrities so he could become sort of in with the crowd, I guess. It seemed like it was crazy.
Pretty much. Yeah, go check those out. Now, taking a look at a couple apps, Travis, what do you use for a weather app on your phone?
What do I use for a weather app on my phone? Typically, I just use weather.
Okay.
The Apple one. So, I literally just look, is it going to be cold today? And what is it? What's the temperature in my other favorite places?
Like, you need to go download What the Forecast. It's been around for a couple of years, but okay. you'll especially love this. It's available for both platforms. WTF, What the Forecast weather app. And it is a weather app with attitude. Like right now, the weather here in Denver is 25 degrees and sunny. And on the screen, it said, this icy weather makes me sad. You know, before, like when it was snowing, it was like, it's really crappy outside. And it gives you this different attitude, and it's a lot of fun. It's free. There are ads at the bottom that come up, but it's, you know, if you want your weather with attitude, it's got all kinds of, okay. So I just refreshed it and it said, who likes frigid crap? Frozen crickets.
Nice. Yeah, little funny jokes in there. That's true. I'll take a look at that for sure.
What the Forecast? The other
it kind of reminds me though, real quick, of the carrot apps. There's these carrot fitness apps that basically are rude to you, and there's like an alarm clock that's the carrot one that they're rude and they'll say rude things to you. Like some people are motivated by people who are jerks to you, right? But yeah, so it's kind of funny. So it reminds me, this is more kind of cutesy and saying funny stuff, where the other one is saying stuff to you to try to motivate you.
Yes. So you could decide, do you want to be motivated or do you want to have cutesy stuff told you? Here's another one that I discovered just recently. You know, we all get those spam numbers, those phone calls from people. Some of them are in our own area code and you pick them up and it's like, hello, my name is Bob. Mm-hmm. Your health insurance, right? This and they use these bots to spoof numbers. Hey. Right. Well, there's an app out now that's called No Neighbor, and it's 99 cents, And allegedly, it is supposed to block all spoofed calls that come from your area code. It's only iOS right now, I believe. Sorry, Android people. But I have purchased and downloaded it, and I'm trying it. And because I'm in the 970 area code, so I'm going to see if those same numbers are now blocked. You know, if I get less calls.
Right, right. That'll be good. Well, I mean, it is it's a 2.8 out of 5 right now, but have you not had any problems with it?
Well, I just installed it. So, but you can also, you can put in there to allow calls from your contacts. So, because there's people I know in this area code and I don't want their calls blocked. So right, you have to give, you know, the app access to your phone book, and then maybe it's going and spamming all of them. I don't know. That would suck. If by that giving them suck. Access to my contacts, all my friends are going to get phone calls now.
Yep. No neighbor. There it is. So if you don't want to be neighborly. Yeah, that's what's so interesting. Like, I live in this neighborhood that I'm in, and like most of the neighbors who I knew, like, they moved, and I haven't like met the new ones. There's a couple of them like right across the street. Although there's another dude right across the street who has my exact name, not my middle name, but like, so I'll get Travis Wright stuff from him, and then he'll get Travis Wright stuff from me, like once every couple of weeks, and we like return each other's other Travis Wright stuff.
Don't be antisocial, Travis. Go say hi to your neighbors.
No, all right. Neighbor, no.
Let's check out some of the gadgets. Gadget, that is French for gadget, don't you know?
Oh, you love the gadgets.
You know, remember, baguettes. I was telling you at CES, Google had a huge presence. You know, they had their own building and a track ride to talk about, hey, Google, which is the Google Assistant. And I just set off a bunch of devices, maybe even a billion devices, because apparently Google Assistant now has connected to a billion devices, and it is all out war with Amazon's Alexa, play the Bad Crypto Podcast.
I wish we could change the name of Alexa. I want to change it to like Wiretap. Please, well, play me. Dear Wiretap, will you please turn on Spotify? Thank you.
You actually do have choices now with the Amazon device.
Yeah.
So speaking of Wiretap, one of the gadgets that I picked up at the Consumer Electronics Show was a device called the Mute Plus, made by Smart E, I believe. And it's this little device that you put on top of your Amazon, you know, Alexa or your Dot. And you push the button on top of it, and it filters. It like it makes so that your Amazon device isn't always listening. It only listens when you push the button on it. So those that are concerned about privacy, you might want to take a look at one of these privacy filters. This is called the Mute Plus. I don't think this device is available to the public. I think they sent me an early release, but you could be watching for it soon. And if you just type, you know, home device filter, they're probably not the only ones that are making something like this.
Mm-hmm. Oh, back to that weather app you were talking about. So in the settings area, you can actually update the profanity settings, modify the creepy voice, and a bunch of other crap. That's pretty handy. So like, it can like really cuss at you.
So Google's got 1 billion devices now. It's a pretty big deal because Amazon revealed that they have sold more than 100 million Alexa-enabled devices. Of course, a lot of the billion devices that Google's talking about are Android phones that have Google Assistant pre-installed. So, you know, I'm sure that they haven't sold near that many home devices yet.
Well, I mean, I wonder how many Android devices there are worldwide, because most of them now have Google Assistant in it, right? So
yeah.
That's one thing that gives them an advantage over the Alexa device is that, you know, not everybody has on their phone, like mine thing is listening for Siri, right? It's not listening for Amazon. And I could put Google Assistant on there, but Google's been a little creepy lately. So I've been not using Google as much. And, but 100 million devices, that's pretty impressive, especially when you can access all their services.
I think easily. We should put, hey, Google and Alexa and Siri in a room and let them battle it out.
Mm-hmm. They just had one of them come out as the winner.
Right.
And it was like that one. That way they only have to listen one time. They don't have to have multiple devices. Make it easy.
I haven't used the Google Assistant. Is it a female voice?
You know, good question. You know who would know that would be perfect? Would be Stuart Rogers, because he always has Android devices.
Well,
but he's not here today.
Any of the millions of people that also have one, because I know both Siri and the Alexa are, you know, have a female voice. So mm-hmm. I'm wondering, I want mine to respond to me in a French maid voice. Monsieur Joël, how can I help you today? Right? Why not?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, why not? There are some really funny voices that can pop up on Android. You can't really mess with the one on Apple as much, but on Android you can have all kinds of funny voices, like Darth Vader telling you what to do.
Turn left at Quindaro Boulevard.
You know, it's like, that's funny.
Can you do Arnold also? You know, so like you pull out of the driveway and he says, "You'll be back."
Mm-hmm. Yes, could probably do all of that. I don't know. All right, what else is new?
How do you pronounce this? Xiaomi's? Xiaomi. It's a Chinese.
I think it's Xiaomi.
Xiaomi?
Xiaomi.
Xiaomi, I show you. Apparently, this company has created a bendable phone. It's a folding phone that actually folds into three. And this thing is coming out pretty soon. It can, you know, could be like a tablet or a compact phone. And the folks over at The Verge say it's the best one that they've seen so far.
You know, it's interesting but look at the way he's holding it. He's got his thumbs on both sides. He's bracing with his finger. It is kind of a bigger screen. It's wider. It really sort of looks like an iPad mini that's just a little bit shorter. Like, that's about how much screen you would have.
Yeah.
But that folding thing to me, I'm not sure, because what I use on the back of my phone are these two little Velcro strap things that is called lazy hands. So I just basically slide my two fingers and hold my phone. And so it's much less stress on your tendons. I'm not clutching the phone or anything. It's just way easier. The three screen phone. Man, I don't know. What do you think?
I think you could still probably do that, Mr. Travis, right? Put your little, you know, thing on the back, like a pop socket or whatever. But I'll tell you what, they're not the only ones that are building these. In fact, remember the Razer phone? Everybody had a Razer phone before we had the smartphone. And Motorola woke up to see that they lost all of the market to Apple and the iPhone and then eventually Android. But they're back. The Moto G7 phone, the G7, the G7 Plus, the G7 Power, and the G7 Play are phones that fold in half. And they think you guys are going to buy them.
Wow, I need to look at this here. How do they fold?
In half.
In half? Yeah. Wow. No, it looks like, okay, that is interesting. I need to see one of these. It's hard to tell when you're looking like half pictures of them.
Yeah, so it's a new Razer. And, of course, the Razer brand is known for being a flip phone. So now you've got the smartphone that allegedly flips in half. Of course, they're going to be running on Android. And you could check out the specs for each of these devices on the show notes with the link to this article. But it looks like they've got some pretty cool features here. I don't know that, you know, apparently it's $1,500 for a foldable phone, but it is compact and people do like things that are small.
Well, you know, if I was looking at both of those, the Motorola versus the Xiaomi, that Xiaomi one is innovative. It's different. The way that it folds, it's folding in and the screen is staying out. That's an innovative design. It comes out looking pretty cool. I would say the Xiaomi phone would be way better than the Motorola phone. The Motorola phone looks like it's trying to solve a problem that doesn't exist.
Mm. Yeah.
I wish them well. They're an American company. So, you know, I believe.
Yeah. You guys figure it out for yourself here. A couple more gadgets to take a look at. Were you aware that Facebook has created a speaker? It's called the Portal. And there's another one called the Portal Plus. It's a smart speaker.
Well, that's their Portal speaker, but then they also have the main Portal. You've probably seen those commercials on TV.
I don't watch commercials. I don't watch TV, so no, I don't know.
So you've actually never seen the Facebook Portal, their cameras, and basically they move like as you're moving in the camera space, the camera follows you around, If you stand up, it's so the camera is AI powered, following you around, and then you can have calls with other people who have this. It's like a just a little video communication portal.
That's not creepy at all.
From Facebook.
Yeah, that's Facebook is just a mega creepy to me. Period. Like tracking everything. So now you can get a speaker as well. Apparently, they were available in time for Christmas. So that's how delayed I am on this. Mm-hmm.
I like the idea. It looks cool, but if, like, when you know how much data Facebook is consuming and what they know about you, and it's like, is it listening all the time? Are they grabbing that data? You really don't know, because there's been so many breaches and so many loss of trust with these companies anyways, that it's hard to have faith in them.
Well,
with your data,
you might want to buy one of those. But here's a gadget that none of us are going to be buying. But I saw this on TechCrunch and I thought, oh, this is so cool. Did you know that there are self-driving submarines, autonomous subs that are swimming around underneath the Antarctic ice shelf?
Huh. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, these things are down there. They've been down there for a year or so. And they, Paul Allen, you know, who was with Microsoft, mm-hmm. he left a grant when he passed away for them to do this thing. And they're seeing how climate change is affecting the sea ice. They're taking measurements, and they're going places that, you know, you can't go easily to track this data and see what's going on. This is fascinating. You guys have to go check out.
What kind of battery are they using on this thing? Because I want to have one of those on my phone. I mean, seriously, how often does it come up for charging? Because it's like, it's autonomous. It's out there forever. Oh, yeah? Well, give me that charging stuff you got going on over there. I love this. I think this is cool. And I've done a lot of research on Antarctica. And it's just, I would love to see Antarctica with not now, because if all the ice melts, then obviously the earth changes. But the Antarctica didn't used to be covered in ice, right? Antarctica has like mountains, and like they have like a thing that looks like it could be some pyramids on Antarctica.
Allegedly. So who knows?
Yeah, allegedly. I'd love to see. They need to use like LIDAR over it and then like eliminate through that ice to see, what does Antarctica actually look like? Have people ever lived there before? Because that would be crazy to know.
Yeah, that would be cool. Well, apparently one of these sea gliders went 87 miles on a single trip. So, yeah, if you can get that battery for your phone, that would be badass. Speaking of badass, yourself and Mr. Stuart Rogers had the opportunity to visit with Mike McAvoy, who is the CEO of the hilarious publication, The Ungen. And we're going to play you that interview right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a great treat for us today. We have, I would call a king of satire, essentially, or sitting at the top of the satire empire. We have the president and CEO of The Onion, Mike McAvoy. Welcome to VB Engage, good sir.
Thank you for having me.
What did you say about the how did you pitch that? The satire?
The king of satire?
Yeah, well, sitting at the satire, like, it was what publication has more satire than...
The higher the satire, the better it is.
The higher the satire.
That's amazing. Yeah. The Onion, I'm such a huge fan of The Onion. I love the fact that The Onion exists. I love the fact that actually a lot of your stories sound truer than real life, which is often, I think, the secret to great humor, right?
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, the team puts a ton of effort into making sure that every headline they're craft, you know, has an insight behind it and kind of, you know, has a truth that's underneath it. So while maybe hyperbolic on kind of what you read at first, when you get through the whole article, you actually think about what that headline meant. It's actually highlighting some truth in society.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that's the beautiful thing about humor, is if you can tie it into what's really going on in the world, then it just really hits home and it punches hard. With that, do you do anything in terms of split testing headlines and showing different headlines to different people and measuring which ones are working and switching them on and off and that kind of thing?
We don't. I mean, we do a lot of work with kind of being smart about distribution. If you're, particularly on the branded content side, if you're trying to kind of amplify something, which piece to do based on how effective it is. But on the kind of core headline side, it's more art than science. You know, it really is a writer's room culture of picking the best headlines that you think are going to mean the most for an audience and that you believe in the most as a room. That said, you know, there's a ton of analytics around what works and what doesn't work. We also found that if you just run a satire organization through the lens of analytics, all you'll write about is sex, tech, and celebrities, or all three of them together. So at some point, you know, while data is super important in terms of how you think about your business, I personally think it always has to be art plus science, or art and, instead of just science driving art.
Mm. Yeah. Kim Kardashian's vibrator broke and she's in the hospital.
That's sex, tech, and celebrities.
Sex, tech. That's right. Yeah. Everyone's good. Like, oh my God, that's amazing.
That's the best news ever. Yeah.
And I think at some point, like, you know, I think we've seen this over the internet over the years where there's people who just take the race to the bottom based on, you know, kind of how to game a system. Whether you look back at way back in, you know, the day with Demand Media, who was just writing SEO content. I think you've seen a ton of companies, you know, fall within Facebook who are just trying to game that system. So I think it's always a delicate balance, you know.
Yeah, so, you know, this is – the Onion's been around for quite a while. When was it founded?
It was founded in 1988, so it turns 30 in August, which is insane for a humor publication.
That is. I mean, it's one of those things like the National Lampoon, you know, and then the Onion. I mean, it seems like it's on the same sort of level of quality. I'm curious, like, what makes a great writer at the Onion, right? And you're creating lots of content. You know, I'm a pretty sarcastic person. I know Stewart's pretty sarcastic. He's got lots of puns and funny. We're always cracking jokes. But and we're both writers. But what makes a great Onion writer?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an interesting, you know, question, and it's something people, you know, ask about a lot. And, you know, in, like, it kind of starts with a love of the brand, you know, and a love of the content we create. And so the, like, great Onion writers want to be great Onion writers, and it takes a lot of work to become great. It's not about being smart. It's not about being funny. It's not about being a great writer. It's about being all those things and really learning how to craft the Onion voice. So how do you write in a news voice to tell a headline when you may have a, you know, a very funny thing to say? There's a certain structure to an Onion headline that makes it hit so hard. And that is something that is not, you know, people don't inherit, you know, like they have to learn over time. That said, you know, there's some people come with us with more talent than others, but it's a, it really is a unique individual.
You have like a training program? Like, oh, here's the how to be funny. Great satire. 101.
That's what it's called. We have a fellowship program where there's 1,000 people who apply for 2 fellowship jobs every 6 months. You know, we hire 2 of those people for 6 months. They go to the writer's room every day. They submit headlines. They learn, you know, kind of why the editor-in-chief picks the jokes that they're picking. You know, learns the discussion. How do you kind of analyze what the target is, and how do you make sure that what we're actually writing is saying something? So yeah, it's a very, you know, it's an apprentice program, you know, or a fellowship program, but it's very much learn on the job.
We talk a lot about emerging technologies on VB Engage, and last year, every single week there was a brand new artificially intelligent solution sitting in the marketing tech space. And, you know, we discussed this quite a lot. There are quite a few solutions, especially in the SEO space, where it's AI that's actually writing the headline and it's AI that's writing the subhead. You know, and as writers, we can't help but get a little bit nervous occasionally that maybe our jobs are going to be taken over by, you know, natural language processing and artificial intelligence. Is there anything that you're looking at or working with there?
So the Onion also has a team at Clickhole. You know, which is kind of a parody of all things viral and vapid, and it's a, it's been playing around with kind of AI comedy bot, you know, that can rehash the news from different outlets and rewrite articles. So it's something that we've definitely been working on, you know, and, you know, with a partner of ours who used to work for us, who's also kind of running his own little AI firm. But it's, I think it's super interesting. I think there it's more kind of highlighting the absurdity of some of that stuff where it is today. But ultimately, I think those are going to be interesting questions for any content creator. And I think it all goes back to like that idea from, you know, whether it's Demand Media or people gaming Facebook, like there's some content factory element that will always exist in publishing. And hopefully we get to a point where there's the art, you know, and the hard work and true journalism or true comedy is rewarded more than the kind of crass, simple, kind of content factory stuff.
Yeah, it's more intelligent. Yeah. And that's a lot of times you can read that Clickhole headline and you're going to go, I don't know if this is a real legitimate article that someone has put out that's ridiculous or not. And, you know, and the Onion articles will come out and you're going, this has to fool 40% of the people who are reading this thing. And then, you know, people are sharing it like it's real. And you're like, hello, it's The Onion. So do you guys have like a dumbass commenter of the week or something where you identify like, look at these, can you believe this?
We don't. I mean, the kind of conceit of The Onion is it's a one-way conduit. The only reason it's actually creating content is just to power, you know, to power its advertising business. It's just this very capitalistic, you know, kind of world that we built. And so we haven't really broken voice into kind of like, you know, kind of breaking down the fourth wall and, you know, which I think is one of the strengths of The Onion. The reason it still works as a brand is that it doesn't, you know, it never winks at you. And I think other publications are always winking, like a late night show or, you know, or anything else. And I think in the end that going in and out of character, I think, you know, can hurt, you know, a brand. But
yeah, for sure. So, you know, in terms of the future of The Onion, where do you see, you know, technology playing a further part in what you do? And, you know, what's the real drive for you in terms of using things like marketing technologies? What is there that's going to move the needle for you and keep things going forward? Because, you know, I've noticed, and being in the publishing industry with VentureBeat, you know, obviously more and more people have installed things like ad blockers, which of course have an impact on your ad revenue. So you have to do other things to fill that gap.
Yeah. So I think from like from a business standpoint, I think we're thinking of a few different things. You know, one kind of the basic thing of revenue diversification, because no one wants to just be in the ad business. So for us, it's thinking about what's the membership or, you know, patronage model where people can be part of a club or be closer to The Onion in exchange for some experiences. Not a paywall, but like what's the value exchange there that gets people to be, you know, to people to invest in a brand that they actually care about, you know? So I think that's kind of one side. And then I think we're also working diligently on the long form side to kind of build out more of a TV film business. We have a 3-picture film deal with Lionsgate that we're working on, which is cool. And then I think the TV side as well is also really interesting, you know, and as well as like, I think the podcasting stuff. We had done a podcast a couple months back called A Very Fatal Murder, which was kind of a parody of Serial. It's brilliant. Became the number one podcast on iTunes, you know, for a few days. And it was, you know, just kind of a great way to kind of poke fun at things. And now it's kind of resulted in some development work, which is also exciting.
And we're big fans of podcasts, right?
As you should be.
Somewhat, yeah. They're okay, I think.
Maybe we should do one or something.
You guys do great work. You do great work.
I appreciate that. Well, so I noticed like you guys have the Onion News Network as well, which is, some of those videos are just completely hysterical. Like you guys have nailed that when it comes to like old school broadcaster guy telling you what the news is. And you know, this is just hysterical. So, and I didn't really realize that you guys were doing the a movie deal. So what, can you talk about that or what are some of the movies?
I mean, we're still working on all the ideas, you know, in terms of which ones feel oniony. I think one of the questions from earlier was like, was about the Onion movie that was made in like 2006 or 2008, which was written over 9 years or something in production. It was basically on the shelf at, I think, Fox Regency for a long time, and then eventually just came out because they're like, let's just try this. So I think we're really particular with our brand in terms of, you know, kind of what makes it something that feels oniony, not necessarily kind of the voice of the Onion, which I think is more limiting, but more from the sensibility. So what is smart? What's funny? What has a like point of view? And what kind of topics can you cover that have enough edge to them, yet also enough insight? Like, to me, that's what a good, you know, Onion film is.
Awesome. Let me ask you this. Are we oniony?
You guys are pretty good.
Pretty oniony. Yeah.
Excellent.
That's good.
I like that. You know, we try to make this show, you know, have that feeling that you've just been slicing onions and you are crying, but usually for the wrong reasons. Right. You know, we go for humor, but most of the time we just make our audience cry.
Yeah. One thing is I always bust his balls about. It's like, is that, you know, the improv, yes and. Stewart is no, but.
Yeah.
That's because I'm British. that's because I'm British. And it's also because you come up with ridiculous compound words that just make no sense whatsoever. And I have to shut you down. Yeah. I just have to do it. Yeah. Talking of shutting you down, Mike, I'm really sorry, but we have to bring this interview to an end because we only have a certain amount of time for our podcast.
And you have an airplane you have to catch.
An airplane I got to catch. So thank you guys so much.
It's been amazing.
Yeah, great stuff there with Stewart and I. We were in Nashville at the EMMA conference, E-M-M-A conference, marketing platform that they have, and got a chance to meet Mr. McAvoy of The Onion. How fun was that?
Super fun. What a great publication. And sometimes...
For decades they've been doing it.
Sometimes the headlines on The Onion actually seem to mimic what we're seeing in media. Like some of the actual media, real headlines would seem like they're parodies that would fit well on The Onion. It's hard to tell the difference between what's real and what's fake.
Are you saying it's hard to tell the difference between real and fake news?
That's what I'm saying.
Man, it is.
That's
got to be diligent out there.
That's what I'm saying. Hey, thanks everybody for listening to Bad Boys of Tech. We hope that you're enjoying the show, this format. We would love for you to give us some feedback, and Mr. Travis Wright will tell you what email to reach out to us at.
badboysoftech@gmail.com. Send us an email over there. That would probably be the best way to get in touch with us for now. We also have Bad Boys of Tech Twitter handle. We'll be using that more as we're growing this bad boy. So connect with us there. Probably the two best places.
Yeah. And if you are an electronics gadget manufacturer of any kind and you want us to take a look at your product, then email us there as well. Tell us what you got for us to look at, and we'll email you back with an address that you can ship that to so we can play with your gadgets.
And there you go, Mr. Joel Kahn. That was an episode.
I love talking about technology, Mr. Travis Wright, and hopefully you guys are enjoying it too. By now, we should be appearing in all the podcast places, and we would appreciate your reviews and your feedback, especially if you really like us. If you don't, and you were about to give a review that was like, you know, not five star, then, oh, look, the toast is burning on your stove, and you need to go deal with that instead.
Yeah, you just got a text. Alexa, play the Bad Crypto Podcast.
We'll catch you guys.
You go turn that off.
Catch you guys next time.
The Bad Boys of Tech.